starting with the farmers' protest. In September 2020, the Parliament passed three key farm acts that have resulted in widespread protests by farmers across the nation. These acts include the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Promotion and Facilitation Act, the Farmers Empowerment and Protection Agreement on Price Assurance and Farmers Services Act, and the Essential Commodities Amendment Act. Of the three acts, the Farmers Produce Trade and Commerce Act have been the most contentious. It circumvents the Government Controlled Agriculture Produce and Market Committee, or APMC market yards, also referred to as the mandis, allowing farmers to sell their produce to private traders. The APMC yards, or wholesale markets, serve as a safety net for the farmers against the fluctuation of retail prices, unpredictable climate patterns, and also assure government procurement and storage at a fixed price called the minimum support price. Although the bill would eliminate middlemen and provide greater autonomy to farmers with respect to their produce, they fear that the trading will steadily move out of the APMC yards, leading to a loss of revenue and weakening of the mandi system. Furthermore, if government procurement at MSP rates ceases, farmers are apprehensive that they would be left at the mercy of powerful private traders. If we look at the impact of the farmers' protest, several widespread demonstrations and nationwide road blockades have been organized at major highways, along with railway blockades in the Delhi, Punjab, Haryana region. In November 2020, protest marches were organized by the farmers of different states to the capital of Delhi, and localized protests took place in multiple cities outside government offices, offices of ruling parties, as well as big corporate offices of agriculture businesses. The protests have primarily been centered around the national capital of Delhi, with several important borders blocked by the farmers. These include the Ghazipur, Tikri, Dhansa, Jharora, and Singo borders. The situation turned volatile in Delhi on 26 January 2021, when the farmers took out a large-scale tractor rally. Heavy security with multi-layered barricades were installed, particularly at the borders. Clashes between the farmers and the security personnel were also reported. This resulted in temporary suspension of internet services in Delhi and Haryana. A nationwide chakka jam, or road blockade, was also held on 6 February that disrupted transport across national and state highways and roadways. Farmer groups also held a nationwide rail blockade on 18 February, with sit-in protests on railway tracks across several states, particularly those leading to Delhi. Heightened security was deployed at various locations by government authorities. Looking at the forecast, continuous demonstrations and road blockades have impacted the travel and transport industry, predominantly in Delhi NCR border areas. These could continue to hinder employee commute in the region. An increase in the intensity of protests in the Delhi NCR region could also lead to suspension of metro services at short notices. Security measures are anticipated to remain heightened at various protest sites. Lastly, intermittent talks between farmer groups and central government officials will continue, and a negotiated settlement to the dispute remains possible.
Thank you, Ishita, for giving such a concise and clear picture of the ongoing protest. I would now be talking about the protests in the labor sector due to a recent push towards privatization. The year 2020 was marked by a number of protests against the modification of labor laws and privatization of public sector units, including airports, railways, and merger of banks. Through the course of 2019 and 2020, the Government of India revised 44 labor laws of the country into 4 broad labor codes. These labor codes include Code on Wages 2019, Code on Social Security 2020, Code on Industrial Relations 2020, and Code on Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions 2020. The initiative was taken to facilitate ease of doing business in the country and simplify procedures for domestic as well as international business investments. However, as these new labor laws were introduced without the tripartite consultation with all stakeholders, as per the International Labor Organization's convention, the joint platform of 10 central trade unions resisted the modifications by the government. The alterations have been perceived by the unions as business-friendly in most aspects instead of being worker-friendly. People from various other sectors have also extended their support, including the transport and banking sector. The central government also promoted privatization of airports in the country, wherein airports are being leased to private enterprises for a period of 50 years. Under this initiative, operations, management, and development of the airports will be done based on the public-private partnership model. In February 2019, six airports, including those of Ahmedabad, Lucknow, Mangalore, Thiruvananthapuram, Jaipur, and Guwahati, were leased to Adani Enterprises. Six more airports, namely Varanasi, Bhubaneswar, Amritsar, Indore, Raipur, and Trichupalli, have also been shortlisted for privatization. With regards to the railway sector, the government announced in July 2020 that 151 trains, which make up 5% of the total trains in India, in 109 routes, will be operated by the private sector for 35 years. Privatization of public sector banks, ports, and power sector is also being undertaken by the central government. The impact of this initiative has been manifold. It has resulted in strikes and protests by trade unions, employees, and opposition parties across different states. Nationwide strikes and shutdowns were also observed, which disrupted the business operation. Protests were held at state level, district level, with support from workers in the informal sector as well. While employees in the power sector participated in a token work boycott across the country, localized protests were organized by the railway, banking, port employees, and other unions. The United Forum of Bank Unions has called for a protest on 15th March, which will culminate in a two-day strike. As a result, delay protests in all states, districts, and towns are most likely to occur between this period of 20th February to 15th March. As alterations to the labor laws are often suspected to empower the management, it is imperative that the government and the corporates prioritize healthy labor practices to avoid such agitations in the future, especially at a time when the operations are already critical in this economic period.
We now move on to some key incidents of civil disturbance. The Citizenship Amendment Act was passed by the central government in 2019. Widespread protests were organized against the act, along with agitations against National Register of Citizens, NRC, and National Population Register, NPR. Large-scale protests were organized across the nation, with central location of the protest in Shaheen Bagh, Delhi, for over 3 months. Previously, nationwide protests were organized against CAA, leading to heavy security deployment and blocking of roadways and internet shutdowns. The continued protests in New Delhi blocked roads for months, affecting over 100,000 vehicles per day. The Delhi riots of February 2020 were also triggered in relation to the protests, which led to violence, stone pelting, and arson, killing 53 people and injuring over 200. Subsequently, heavy security was deployed, and Section 144 of the CRPC was also imposed in various areas in the northeast of Delhi, restricting gathering of more than four people. The outbreak of COVID-19 simmered down the protests. However, fresh protests are likely to break out in the coming months. In December 2020, around 18 organizations in Assam, alongside student and youth organizations, relaunched anti-CAA protests across the state, demanding rescind of the legislation. And in January 2021, a three-day protest was also launched in the state against CAA.
In 2020, we saw multiple protests and agitations being held across the country over various issues. An ongoing issue which leads to massive disruptions year after year is that of the reservation. India provides reservation to socially and economically backward and disadvantaged groups in education, employment, and politics. These groups include the scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, other backward classes, and the economically weaker sections. A few of the protests which have continued in 2020 and are likely to still have an impact in the coming months will now be discussed. In Maharashtra, the Maratha agitation is organized under the banner of the Maratha Kranti Morcha, which has staged state-level protests during the last few months. The group took out the Sangharsh Yatra and the Mashal Yatra to seek reservation in jobs and education. The agitations have remained peaceful, but have shifted from the Marathawada regions of the state to the financial capital of Mumbai. In Karnataka, the demand for reservations by various communities has been increasing, all at the same time. Currently, the Panchamashali Lingayas, classified under Category 3B of the backward classes list, are demanding to be moved to Category 2A, which would provide them with a 15% quota in education and employment. The seers from the community began a Padyatra, a foot march, from Kudula Sangama to Bangalore in early February. Following the agitations of the Panchmashali Lingayats, the Veerashaiva Lingayats are also demanding an OBC status. Additionally, at a separate rally in February, attended by thousands, members of the Kuruba community demanded the scheduled tribe status to replace their current OBC status. The rally is ongoing and is expected to remain strong as it has received an overwhelming response in the state. In Tamil Nadu, the pro-reservation agitation led to rail and road blockades by the Patli Makkal Katchi near Chennai. The demonstrations were held in support of the Vanyar community's demand for a 20% reservation in government jobs and education in the state. The protests are currently going strong in Chennai, Coimbatore, Salem, and Krishnagiri, where the agitators are routinely blocking roads and protesting outside of government offices. Arguably, one of the strongest pro-reservation agitation is that of the Gujjar or the Gurjar community in Rajasthan. The Gurjar Arakshan Sangharsh Samiti is demanding backlog vacancies to be filled, reservation in the 9th schedule of the constitution, and a 5% reservation to the most backward classes in the recruitment process. The agitations began in November and continued for a period of almost 2 weeks, severely affecting the Delhi-Mumbai rail and other road travel as the agitators undertook a chakka jam or a wheel blockade. The protests were called off after negotiations were successful between the agitating leaders and the Rajasthan government. However, based on the strength of the community, both in its number and its influence, further disruptions may occur if negotiations fail. Amongst various other factors, the two major ones determining the growth of these agitations in the coming months are the upcoming state elections and the sub-categorizations of the OBC. In the backdrop of the state assembly elections to be held in Gujarat in 2022, leaders of the two sects of the Patidar community have begun discussions on the political, social, and educational progress of the community. While the movement has remained peaceful since 2015, it could gain momentum as state elections near closer. The sub-categorization of the other backward classes, as per the recommendations of Justice G. Rohini Commission, will also determine reservation demands in other states.
Moving on to the risk of elections, we look at both the upcoming state assembly elections and the simultaneous elections. Upcoming elections in India this year will include elections to the Vidhan Sabha or the legislative assemblies in the four states of Tamil Nadu, West Bengal, Assam, and Kerala, and in the Union Territory of Puducherry. Elections during the COVID-19 pandemic have been viewed with apprehension due to the high health risks involved. However, India was able to successfully conduct elections in Bihar, which has been hailed as a possible model for other states to adopt. Another significant challenge beyond mitigating the health risk during this election season will be of disinformation and its impact on rising political violence in these poll-bound states. The first upcoming election will be in Tamil Nadu, where contesting parties have requested for elections to be held in the last week of April. The political environment in Tamil Nadu has remained relatively stable and will see the ruling party, All India Anna Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam AIADMK BJP Alliance, and the opposition, Dravida Munnetra Kazhagam DMK Congress Alliance, along with other parties, contest the elections. Kerala will show whether Congress is able to repeat its Lok Sabha election success or the left gets an opportunity to retain a degree of national significance. Kerala will also be a test for the BJP, which had pinned its hope on the Sabarimala temple entry issue, but has not yet seen the dividends it expected. In West Bengal, the situation is tense as the Trinamool Congress, TMC, led by Mamata Banerjee, will be facing a sizable opponent in BJP after having been in power since 2011. From holding 3 seats in the 2016 Bengal Assembly elections to winning 18 of Bengal's Lok Sabha seats, the BJP is now growing consistently in the region. While the TMC retains a stronghold in southern Bengal, BJP has gained ground in the northern region, in the districts of Darjeeling, Jalpaiguri, and Koch Bihar. In the months leading up to the election, Bengal has witnessed heightened violence between the two parties and party members during the election rallies. Both the parties have been focusing on identity politics of ethnicity, religion, and caste, and appealing to their respective vote banks while also continuing stiff criticism of the other. in preparation for further communal polarization at the local level and violent clashes in the region, the Election Commission of India has announced the deployment of paramilitary forces near polling stations days before the elections begin. In a game of alliances, Assam election will test the strength of the BJP after the tumultuous protest against the CAA and the NRC. The BJP has renewed its alliance with the Assam Gan Parishad, AGP, after AGP walked out over its opposition to the CAA. At the local level, BJP also ended its partnership with the Bodoland People's Front and roped in United People's Party Liberal instead. In opposition, the Congress has announced a grand alliance with the left parties and other newly formed parties with the potential to disrupt BJP's stronghold in Assam.
Elections in India happen every year, while the biggest, more attractive, and definitely riskier happens every 5 years. The state assembly elections and by-elections happen every year as the term of each state assembly follows its own routine, which is separate from the term of the central government. The current party in power, the BJP, has suggested reverting back to a system of simultaneous elections, a practice which was abandoned after 1967. Presently, the BJP does not enjoy the assured majority that would vote in favor of such a constitutional amendment and is merely signaling the change to test waters. The points in favor of the simultaneous elections point out the benefits of reduced costs, reduced engagement of security machinery, and a better utilization of government resources. On the other side, those skeptical of one nation, one election point out that this could erode India's federal structure and would benefit only the BJP, the richest party, which has the resources to focus on the national and simultaneous state elections, a privilege which is not enjoyed by most regional parties. A bill on the matter has not been proposed yet. However, when it does, strong opposition can be expected from the states which are not governed by the NDA alliance.
A debate on another key manifesto point of the current and central current central government has been on the implementation of a Universal Civil Code, UCC. The debate currently is still in its nascent form, views whether the adoption of a UCC would lead to greater gender equality in personal matters of marriage, divorce, custody, adoption, and inheritance. It is intended to replace the system of fragmented personal laws within different religious communities. Initially supported by women's rights organizations, it is now being viewed as a tool which could homogenize cultures and dilute Article 25 of the Indian Constitution, which guarantees the right to freedom of religion. On the other hand, reforms to personal laws have been inconsistent, and the formulation of a universal code could ensure consistency. The Supreme Court took up the subject in 1985 during the Ahmed Khan versus Shah Banu Begum and others case, and has since made note of it occasionally every few years. In 2018, during the legislation on criminalizing triple talaq, which led to multiple protests across the country, the debate was once again brought into the public domain. While there currently exists no framework of what this code will look like, owing to its sensitive nature of dealing with religious customs and personal laws, it will be met with a strong challenge from the minority communities.
All right, thanks very much, both Bhavna and Ishita, for the quick overview and the insights across the spectrum of the socioeconomic risks for 2021. Thanks very much.